The map here on the table shows the path proposed at the present time for the high-speed rail. And as you see, we're moving along here by Willow Springs. So it's north of Willow Springs. And
that's a good thing. We value you.
Crosses Rosamond Boulevard.
We value you more than you know.
Near Willow Springs. And moves along here.
But it would be different. This is, what I'm thinking is it would sound like a semi truck going by you at 80 miles an hour on the freeway.
Oh, no.
Not the diesel, but the, you know, is it going to have that?
Yeah, you're going to have a little wood. But you're going to have electric, so that you're going to have the diesel sound that makes sound.
Here's Avenue A.
Really get into nitty gritty. And the document.
Of course, on the flip side.
So down here at about 35th and Avenue B, there'll be sidetracks.
And well, they're going to go and punish people who drive cars to help pay for this, because there's no other way it's going to pay for it.
I do see a lot of familiar faces, but I also see a lot of new faces. How many folks have come to one of these meetings previously? All right, so that's about half. Wonderful. So we're going to try to split the difference, right? We're going to try to make sure that the folks who are new get the information that perhaps you might have seen before if you've come before. And for those of you who have been here before, we're going to try to not be too repetitious and try to give you a little more information, a little more detail. Again, once again, we're going to have a facilitated Q&A process. So if in fact you have a question and you haven't filled out a question card, please raise your hand and Claudia will go ahead and get that over to you. We have a gentleman in the back, another one over here. Outreach manager for the Bakersfield, the Palmdale section. While we will be having a conversation about the overall project, we know that you primarily want to hear about what's happening in Rosamond, and you want to hear about what's happening between Bakersfield and Palmdale. So that is much of what we're going to focus on. There are going to be four of us basically speaking. Again, my name is Valerie, and I'll be helping to facilitate. Juan Carlos Velasquez is our project manager, and he'll be providing kind of that overview, that higher level program discussion. We have Rick over here, who is going to be having a conversation about the engineering discussion. Someone asked me earlier, do you have real engineers here? Well, we have a couple of them. I'm blanking. Rob, there you go. I know, I love you, Rob. You know I do. Rob McCann is our environmental engineer, and he is our expert specifically on the Bakersfield to Palmdale section. So he can speak to specifics on the environmental process, what this looks like, how long it's going to take. A lot of people have a lot of questions about the process because they're like, why does this take so long? Rob's that guy who can answer that question. So without further ado, we are going to move this along. Make Paul crazy because I always do the thing. Thank you. There it is. So here's what we'll be talking through during our agenda. We'll be talking about, the higher level California High-Speed Rail program. We'll be talking about specifics within the Bakersfield to Palmdale project section. We'll be talking about high-speed rail project features. We don't have high-speed rail anywhere in the country. So for a lot of folks who haven't been to Asia or who haven't been to Europe, it's hard for them to imagine. They kind of picture Metrolink or Amtrak going 220 miles per hour, which scares all of us, right? That's not good. We don't want to see that. High-speed rails are a unique technology, and we want to make sure that you understand what that project looks like. And then the environmental process, of course, Rob will be talking about the environmental process. So without further ado, here is Juan Carlos.
So as Val mentioned, for some of you who've been at several meetings before, this may sound, maybe you've heard of some of this before, but for the new people, just kind of get to give an overview of what the project is. It's actually a statewide rail modernization program. We are building the high-speed rail system, but we're also improving the rail connections in the urban areas in the north and the south as well. So we're doing improvements to Metrolink and things like that at the same time that we're building this high-speed rail system. So it's a, you know, we built our rail infrastructure here in the 1800s in the state, and you know, slowly we've been trying to improve that throughout the state. So just our project is the blue line, is the phase one that you see here. The main goal of connecting San Francisco, that urban area, all the way down to Anaheim. And the dots that you see there are the station stops that you see where stations are being proposed or studied in the current project. The yellow lines are phase two, which will be done after phase one, and that would extend it north to Sacramento and all the way down south to San Diego. The four dots there are kind of just a reminder of, to talk about what are the benefits, why we're doing this. Increasing mobility. We have 39 million people in the state of California. Projections to 2050 are that we will have another 11 million people or so that will be moving to the state. And you know, previous projections that have been done, you know, they've always been correct, or we've always exceeded that. California just continues to grow. So we have a plan for that. How do we get people around the state, up and down the state, between the cities, from one major city to the next? You know, we need a plan for how we're gonna move people up and down the state, so increasing that. And the needed alternatives. So, you know, in some of the areas of the state, you know, we're maxed out with freeways. We've added, you know, four lanes, five lanes, six lanes. We have like 10, 12 lane freeways, and they're just stuck. So we just can't keep adding freeway lanes because it's just, you know, it's not really, we need an alternative. We need some way, other ways to move people. And we understand not everyone will use the train, but if some of the people get off the freeways and use the train, then the people that are on the freeways will be less congested as well. Our air transportation system is also maxed out. The air market between San Francisco and Los Angeles is the busiest short haul air market in the United States. It's actually congested. If you've ever flown from LA to San Francisco, you've been in San Francisco Airport, at least for me, it seems like every flight is always delayed. They have runway constrictions in San Francisco. Their runways are too close together. And so there's a limited number of planes that can go in and out of there. And we're maxed out. We can't keep adding more and more flights. When we start to have another million more people in LA, another million more people in San Francisco, they're not going to be able to fly back and forth. We need other ways and besides air and roads. And then this is an electric system. So it moves, one high-speed train can move as many people as a four-lane freeway, but it's clean, it's electric, there's no emissions. So that will help to improve air quality, not just for the people riding the train, but if cars are not idling and going slow on the freeways and moving more efficiently, that actually reduces the emissions of the cars as well. And then job growth. Not only short-term job growth, you know, the unemployment rate in the Fresno area where we started construction has done a nosedive. I mean, it used to be the double digits, now it's in the single digits because of all the construction. So, you know, during construction, there's going to be a lot of jobs that are going to be created. There's also permanent jobs for maintenance and operations and training that will be created as a result of this project. So we get a lot of questions about whether it's going to happen, when it's going to happen. So we kind of have this slide about it is happening. We have about 120 miles of construction contracts already ongoing in the Central Valley from north of Fresno down to just north of Bakersfield. You can see some of the pictures there. We have a dozen or so major construction sites in and around Fresno. It kind of was where we started, and it's slowly moving south. And it's been going on for a while now. And so you can see those initial contracts are about $3 billion, where there's a lot of construction that's happening. So there is progress with the project, and here we're moving, you know, to try to get to that point where we can start construction, and we're doing the environmental process. So specifically here, the Bakersfield to Palmdale section, the way we do the project is we develop it basically in sections, station to station. So we had a project that was Fresno to Bakersfield. you know, station Fresno, station in Bakersfield, and here we'll have a project Bakersfield Palmdale, and the station in Bakersfield, and the station in Palmdale. It's about 80 miles, this section, so it's quite a long way. And so we kind of do them in these phases so that they're manageable. It's a very unique section. We go through the Tatry Mountain Range. We have a lot of geographic challenges. So we have a lot of tunneling and things like that. There's also a lot of open space here in this section, in the ranches, in Tone Ranch, things like that. Lots of open space that we go through. We also go through downtown areas and communities and residential areas. So it's very diverse. It's not unlike other sections that maybe are more consistent, where they're just this kind of thing, that kind of thing. This one has a lot of different things that we have to consider. So along with if it's happening, this is kind of a timeline of when it's happening. We've in the back there, I've got a lot of questions about when is it going to start, and when are we going to have construction, things like that. So we kind of put this together just to kind of give you an idea of when we actually started. So it actually started in even before 2005, but in 2005 we actually got the program environmental document approved. Basically, that meant that we did an environmental document for the whole program. It was completed, certified, approved, and all that. So then we started moving in the different sections and advancing the different sections as I mentioned earlier. So this section we launched the environmental, basically starts in what we call scoping, basically notify everyone that we're going to start an environmental process. It actually started in this section in 2009. And between then and now, you can see that between what's pointing to 2010 and 2015, we've been doing alternatives analysis. We've been studying a lot of alternatives. Meanwhile, other things have been happening. You know, we've had the groundbreaking in the Central Valley. And you can see the timeline that we're going to do the draft environmental document. In 2025, we expect to start running trains between Bakersfield, essentially, to San Jose. And then we will continue to build and all that, and our plan right now is to complete phase one, San Francisco to Anaheim, by 2029. So that kind of gives you an overall timeline. So as we move forward, as we develop the project, we have a lot of things to consider. We definitely have a lot of community issues and concerns that we have to consider. So we put this together to kind of give you an idea. There's three priorities. You know, we have our own priorities, and we want the train to be fast as possible, shortest route. We want it to be safe, so our curves have to be designed in a certain way. To deal with the roads and things like that. So we want to have a very safe. We need to put the stations where it attracts the most riders. So we have all of our objectives that we're trying to meet. And then there's also environmental resources. We can't, we have to consider streams or habitat for certain, animals and things like that. We have to try to protect our, natural lands. And at the top there you see community. We also need to consider the community, protect community resources and things like that. So those priorities, sometimes are the same, and oftentimes they're not the same. They're kind of competing. And the idea is that not one is pulling the project in their direction, that we're trying to compromise basically among all three of these to find the best project that we can do. This and various other meetings. So you can see at the bottom that we've had over 200 meetings just in the last couple of years. We have small group meetings that we do with stakeholders and agencies. We do large public open house meetings like this. We go and speak to, Rotary Club or Kiwanis Club. Any organization that invites us to speak, we go out to do that, and just to kind of get people engaged and so that we can get that feedback and we understand what the concerns of the communities are. And what happens when we do that is the routes change. We hear about some things, and so from either environmental agencies or from communities or our own design advances, and we decide, there was an issue here, we have to design around it. So you can see over time how the route has changed, and that has been as a result of those issues. Feedback from the community, studies in the environmental side, and also our own advanced engineering. So here in Bakersfield Palmdale, here's the map that we currently have. The map that you see there there's some color coding. The pink sections are tunnels. We have a lot of tunneling to do in the Tatry Mountains because we basically, we have to go straight as flat as possible. And the ground doesn't generally agree with that. It goes up and down, so we have to either tunnel or bridge in a lot of different places. And we've done refinements over time, really just to kind of improve the route as much as we can. And you know, it's never going to be perfect, you know, but we're trying to achieve the best route we can for everyone. I'm going to take a break here, and Rick will go through the project in more detail. I'll walk through the section from north to south and give you a little more detail on what the design will look like and the various parts of the project. In Bakersfield, we're looking at two station options. Recently, our board has concurred with at the F Street site as the preferred alternative for the station in Bakersfield. That's still going through their environmental analysis, but fortunately, right now, we have a preferred alternative for the F Street site in Bakersfield. Coming east out of Bakersfield, it goes through the community of Edison. We come off the rail alignment and follow the 58 freeway. We have two alternatives. Basically, one is on the north side of the freeway, and the other is on the south side of the freeway. Kind of setting up a combined corridor of the freeway and high-speed train right next to each other. This avoids the community of Edison, avoids the Edison Middle School, and all of the agricultural packing operations that are along the railroad through the community of Edison. Rendering of what a viaduct structure might look like going over one of the valleys. We approach the top of the mountain, we go past the Tehachapi Loop and come into the community of Tehachapi and go across the Tehachapi Valley. Again, short tunnels, some bridges as we climb up the mountain. When we get into Tehachapi, we swing north of town and then around the east side of the town, we cross the 58 freeway near Denison Road. And then we go over the Union Pacific track and across the Tehachapi Valley, basically on an embankment with bridges where we cross the roads. Coming down the south slope of the Tehachapis, we have a couple of longer tunnels. Then we cross the Garlock Fault in between those two tunnels. When we cross a major earthquake fault, we don't want to be in tunnel, we want to be above ground. So that's the area in between those two purple tunnels is where we cross the Garlock Fault above ground. We also cross the Pacific Crest Trail in that area. We're looking at options to minimize our impacts on the trail. And again, you see our cross-sections and our renderings of where we're on structure, where we're in tunnel, and where we're on embankment. Coming down through the Rosamond area, we are on basically on an embankment, about 25 feet above ground. So we can go over the streets. We cross the streets, we'll have a bridge. In between the streets, we'll have an embankment. And our alignment comes through here. We try to get as far away from the exotic key line compound as we can without impacting the raceway. So that's kind of threading the needle between those two facilities. We're trying to be as far west as we can. Coming through the community here. Also mentioned, we talked a little bit about maintenance facilities and some of the permanent jobs that we'll have here. We are planning a maintenance facility that will maintain the track and the guideway around Avenue B. So there'll be some permanent jobs there for the workers at the station there to maintain a long section of the alignment. Also, we've got a lot of questions about how this will be configured. We also, in addition to the bridges crossing the streets, we will have culverts through the embankment for drainage purposes and also for wildlife connectivity. As we come into Lancaster, we swing across the 14 freeway right around Avenue D, and then we align ourselves alongside the Union Pacific tracks as we go down through Lancaster and Palmdale. So we're setting up a combined rail corridor again, which you see in the picture in the lower right. We have Sierra Highway, then the high-speed train, Metrolink, and the Union Pacific all lined up in one corridor. We have two different options. One option basically leaves Sierra Highway where it is and builds things to the east. The other option would leave the Union Pacific where it is today and moves things to the west.
Basically, it's the same cross-section, same configuration through town. We'll grade separate all of the crossings, roadway crossings. So we'll have a sealed corridor and grade separate all of the trains from the roadways through Lancaster and Palmdale. And as we come into Palmdale, we go past the Plant 42 facility. Again, another maintenance, potential maintenance facility near Avenue M. This would be a vehicle maintenance facility. And again, several more permanent jobs, if that facility is placed there. We come along the west side of the Union Pacific through here to avoid Plant 42. And we have our station in Palmdale, very close to where the existing Metrolink station is. We'll have a combined station with Metrolink and high-speed rail so that we can easily transfer between those two systems. We're also allowing a connection to the High Desert Corridor, the Express West high-speed train line that will go from Palmdale to Las Vegas. We're designing that so that that could come in and connect to Palmdale. So from Palmdale, you'll be able to get trains not only to LA, San Francisco, but also Las Vegas. Some of the features of the system. Trains are electric, powered with overhead, what we call overhead catenary wires, over the top of the tracks. You can see pictures there of what that looks like. About every 5 miles, we have a little substation. This is a picture in the upper right. This is how the electrical currents and voltages and everything are standardized along the alignment. We also are going to have an early earthquake warning system. We have a lot of earthquakes here in California, but we'll be building a system that's really going to have statewide benefit, very similar to what the Japanese have. They've had a high-speed train system for 50 years there. They've never had a passenger fatality, and they have more seismic activity than we do here in California. So what the earthquake warning system does is it detects the seismic activity immediately as it starts to happen, and can cut the power to the trains, bring them to a stop before the main waves of the earthquake actually get to the train. And it's been very effective, and as I said, it's not only be a system that will be useful for the high-speed train system, but also elsewhere in the state, giving us more warning for the earthquakes and allowing for emergency responders to react a lot quicker. We'll also have an intrusion protection system. Our right-of-way needs to be sealed. We don't want people, animals, or anybody coming onto the tracks because of the high-speed operation that we'll have. Our system is fully grade separated from all the roadways. In some cases, to achieve that grade separation, we have to take the roadways up and over or take the roadways down underneath our alignment. Through Rosamond, we're going to be on the embankment, so that we're already, really don't have to modify the roadways. We'll be high enough, we just need to build a bridge, and the roadways can pass underneath. But throughout the whole section, we have 73 roadway crossings. So each of these will be grade separated. There's no horns with our trains, there's no gates going up and down because it's fully grade separated from the roadways. And as I mentioned, we have the stations at each end. We have the Bakersfield station. Two options being looked at. We're focusing in on the F Street site as a preferred alternative. In Palmdale, we have the site near where the Metrolink is today. And you see the yellow lines, which is the future line to Las Vegas, and how that could connect in at Palmdale. With that, I'll give it to Rob to talk about the environmental assessments.
Hey, Rick. I'm Rob McCann with the environmental team, so Val will make a note of the name. Just a few more slides to go here. You've been very patient, and then we'll get to your questions and our answers. I wanted to share a little bit about the environmental process. For those of you that were here back 6 months ago, when we were here in July, I think we were about here in terms of doing our studies. As Rick was saying, Juan Carlos said the environmental process began with the scoping several years ago, began identifying alignments, identifying issues to be evaluated. With the alignments being decided for further study in our environmental document, that's when our team went to work to identify and evaluate a number of different topics, which I'll share in a minute. From here, we will be recommending a preferred alternative. That's the four alternatives that we're looking at. That would be presented to the High Speed Rail Authority Board, who may then concur or perhaps modify it. Once they've done that, then we'll publish the draft environmental impact report, environmental impact statement. That'll be out for public review, provide an opportunity for formal public comment on the document, and public hearings will be held during that time. Once that's completed, then we work to address those comments and work to prepare a final EIR, EIS, that is then presented to the board with a final recommendation for a preferred alternative. So the environmental document content, what's in it? Everything from A to almost Z. This lists almost 20 different topics that we evaluate in detail in the document. Those that are typically important in communities, whether you're a resident or a business person, right of way, that's always the first one we hear about. Noise, vibration, air quality effects. But there's lots of other issues we address that are either important to communities, to federal and state regulatory agencies, that all need to be addressed as far as complying with our state and federal environmental laws. What are some of the things we do to conduct those studies? There's a lot of boots on the ground. As you can see here, we have biologists, archaeologists in the field. Up in the right corner there is a noise monitor where we go out and take measurements of existing noise conditions so we can compare what the future noise conditions would be like. And we do a lot of work using analytical tools such as geographic information system analysis, and just a whole variety of things that go into conducting these studies. So why are we conducting these studies? The key is to look at what are the environmental impacts of the project, of the different alternatives we're evaluating. But before we just jump to analyzing impacts, there's really a process we go through, and it's very much of an interactive process where my environmental team works very closely with Rick's engineering team, where as we study things that identify impacts, we bring that back to the engineering and say, hey, is there a way to avoid this impact? And so there's a lot of back and forth in terms of refinement. You know, maybe we skinny up the alignment. Maybe it's a slight shift in the alignment. Maybe we go under a road instead of over a road. So our first focus is to avoid impacts. Once we've settled on, okay, we've done the maximum avoidance we can, then we focus on how do we minimize those impacts. And then finally, we get to mitigation. We have an impact. What are some things we can then develop to help mitigate and offset those impacts? I'm going to share a couple examples with you, but these are only a couple examples. This is the process we go through for each one of those topics that I showed you on the previous slide. For noise, which is always a big concern in any community, first we look at the design. Once we've aligned set the alignment, where do we need sound barriers to protect residents or other sensitive receptors to noise, be it a park or something like that? During construction noise is always a concern. Some of the things we can do are avoiding nighttime construction near residential neighborhoods, using portable sound barriers to try to reduce impacts of noise in construction zones. And then finally, once the project's built, there's ongoing maintenance that occurs to help reduce noise of the project itself, whether it's Rick was talking about the maintenance facilities, that's where they would do rail wheel grinding to help reduce wheel squeal, and then also lubrication on some of the curves. Another example to share is on visual mitigation. People are always concerned, gee, what's this thing going to look like? Well, you know, we can't completely make it completely screened out, but there are a number of things we can do where we have a noise barrier. Sometimes that results in a visual impact. So maybe we can do a transparent barrier. Different design types that can be done with the catenary poles. And then also lots of vegetation where we have opportunities to soften the effect of the look. And these are just some examples. There's a whole palette. Each community, each area is different that we go through. And the designers work to try and develop the best mitigation possible for those effects. So those are just some examples, but again, we go through this process for each of our environmental topics. With that, I think I need to hand it out to Val, and she'll share about some upcoming meetings and get to the questions and answers.
Thank you so much. So we are obviously in Rosamond, but we are going to be in a variety of other places over the next week and a half, 2 weeks, if you want to do this again. or if you have friends who you say, hey, you really should go check this out because, you know, it's interesting, or you may have property that, you know, you may want to see what the impacts are, or they just may be interested in trains, and so maybe they want to have some thoughts about how to develop the process or how to develop the system. You know, we're going to be in Lancaster on Tuesday, January 31st. We'll be, and that is at 5:30, Tehachapi on February 1st. I know we have a couple of friends from Tehachapi in here. Edison, which is just outside of Bakersfield, as you know, will be at Edison Middle School. That'll also be a live webcast as well as bilingual Spanish-English meeting. So if you have friends who actually are more comfortable speaking in Spanish, that may be a nice option for them. Or if they can't get out of the house or don't want to get out of the house, it will be live cast, live webcast. So you can always click in and view the project from that direction. Also in Palmdale, February 7th, we will be in Palmdale at the Chamboli Cultural Center. So again, that's kind of close by too. So if in fact you have someone who wants to attend, that's another option. Again, those other options are at 5:30. This is the one that is at 10 o'clock because it is a Saturday. Okay, so I'm gonna leave that up actually while we start looking at some of our questions.
Well, alternative isn't finalized until the environmental completion, which is in about a year. So we'll come out with an initial preliminary preferred, we'll release the draft for public comment, we'll get that comment back, and maybe it changes from that point forward, and then we have a final, and that would be about a year.
Juan Carlos, I think this is also for you. Alexander wants to know, is this system safe?
Yes, it's very, very safe. That's our goal, is a safe, reliable, modern transportation system. You know, Rick talked a little bit about, you know, how we have to be completely sealed and separating the roads from the track so that we don't, you know, a lot of train incidents happen when, you know, gates come down and the car crosses the gate or something like that, and there's, you know, we won't ever have that situation because all the roads will be separated. So there's, you know, our plan is to be very safe, and that's why we have the geometry we do with the very large curves, so that, you know, you don't have sharp curves where there could be incidents and things like that. But maybe Rick, you want to add some things?
Just to mention that the safety record of these systems around the world, I mentioned Japan. They've been operating for 50 years and have never had a fatality. Nothing is foolproof. There have been a couple of accidents in Europe, but you know, planes crash, trains have problems, cars have problems. Nothing's foolproof. But these systems generally, if you look at the overall safety record, it's a very, very safe mode of transportation.
Yeah, I will mention one other thing that actually MetroLink has started. They were the first system to put it online just within this year, called the Positive Train Control. And what this does is it basically overrides human error. So some of you may remember the Chatsworth accident where the operator ran a signal and it didn't see it or it didn't stop, and so there was a train that collided. We will have what's called positive train control from day one. Basically, this is if a signal's missed or something like that, the trains would automatically know that and would override the. It's kind of what cars are doing now, right? They have the emergency braking if you don't brake yourself.
Okay, and again, we're gonna try to be pretty efficient as we go through this. David wants to know, why are there no stops in the Antelope Valley other than Palmdale?
Well, the idea of high-speed trains is that it doesn't stop a lot because you want it to make fast trips. So you see the map, we do have basically, the stops generally are some distance apart. So that the train is not stopping constantly, but we do have the station here in the Yellow Valley, and it's in Palmdale.
Okay. Ken raised a question about route, and I'm going to augment a little bit. He wants to know why we're not going from Palmdale to Avenue D through Gorman and over to the 5 to Bakersfield, and that I'm going to dovetail on that and speak to the fact that a lot of people ask, why aren't you just going up the 5? So Juan Carlos, if you want to, or Rick.
I'll talk a little about the 5 because we get that question statewide. And the idea of the train is to connect the city centers. So, you know, when you fly from here to Portland or whatever, from LA to Portland, you have to leave downtown and go out to the airport, which is, you know, often like in Denver, it's like 45 minutes out of town.
Then you fly to the next, you know, where your destination is going. Again, it's an hour out of town. Then you drive into the town. And so that, you know, that's a different trip than when you're riding a train from downtown Bakersfield to downtown LA, and you just get out here in the middle of the town. So if you follow the I-5, it doesn't go through the town, it doesn't go through Bakersfield, it doesn't go through Fresno. So it doesn't, you know, it's not really doing that. But we did have some technical issues, considerations about specifically at the Grapevine crossing that, you know, Rick can talk about.
Yeah, we did look at crossing the Tatchies at the Grapevine. It's really a geometric problem in that the mountains are just much steeper at that point. Because you have about a 4,000 foot drop in elevation within a couple of miles, so it would just be very, very steep. Where we're crossing the Tehachapis is actually a much more gradual slope. We're able to get 2.8% grade all the way up the mountains, generally following the terrain. You can see it on our profile. It's on the back table back there. So it really is more the geometry. We found also that we would have actually as much or more tunneling if we went that route. So it was looked at, but really it's not the best place to cross.
Yeah, there's a reason why the first railroad went through the Tatchpe Pass, and that's because it is a more gradual pass.
And the same thing with, why can't we just make a really sharp turn and go through Gorman and then head over to the 5? It needs to be a gradual curve in order to hit Palmdale, Lancaster.
And then gradual curves, and then also getting into downtown Bakersfield is very challenging if you're coming up from the bottom of the Grapevine. It's already too far west.
Okay. Barbara had kind of a variety of questions, but really having to do, it's an environmental discussion with regard to tunnel construction. You know, what are we doing to address soil disruption with regard to valley fever? Any issues that may come up with that from blasting and also just, you know, kicking up dirt, that sort of thing.
Sure. Thank you. With regard to valley fever, we do have a specific discussion of health impacts within the environmental document. Currently, the authority for the portion that's under construction in the Central Valley, there are various protective measures in place, primarily for protection of construction workers, but certainly for nearby residents and other community members. So typically, the goal, you know, since valley fever is caused from a spore, is to keep it watered so that it doesn't disperse. Protecting workers with ventilation equipment, etc. And we would be applying those measures that are currently being used within this section.
I do have some right-of-way questions, Juan Carlos. You probably wanted, they're kind of high-level. First, timing. When might people start getting relocated?
Yeah, typically the right-of-way process doesn't start until we have environmental clearance and approvals. We don't expect that for about a year from now. We'll have our environmental completed. And then it's just a matter of the funding, when the funding becomes available for the construction of this section. Right now we're constructing from Bakersfield to San Jose as the initial, you know, that middle part. You know, you start in the middle and then you go towards the ends. So we don't have an exact timeline of that here, but our goal is to start operations here in 2029. So the thought is, you know, we probably need to start construction here in the early 2020s. So we have a couple of years off before we're going to be doing right away.
Okay, and following suit, if the train goes through my property, basically, you know, will I be paid? How will the cost of my house and my property be determined?
Yeah, there's a process about that. We do have a fact sheet about that. And we have a person here who's an expert that you can speak to him later. You'll be in the back there in the right-of-way station, but essentially it's an acquisition. The state does an appraisal. There's rules about the appraisal. If the owner's not happy about it, you know, they can do their own appraisal. The state actually pays them to do their own appraisal and so they can bring that appraisal to the state, and then, you know, then it's just like a normal property acquisition. You know, the negotiation between the appraisal. That purchase is made. So it's probably more complicated than I'm making it, but I think that's generally it.
And a follow-up question is, how are candidates for relocation kind of chosen? Like, how close do you need to be? What do those impacts need to look like? And that might be a combination of Juan Carlos, you know, and Rob.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, if you're in the route, you know, within the construction area, you know, that's pretty clear. As far as other impacts, you know, Jason, I'm not sure, Rob, maybe you can talk about the termination of that.
Yeah, again, I think as far as any other properties that are outside the what we call the project footprint, that definitely is part of a negotiated process with regard to is it more cost effective to acquire a property than to design all sorts of mitigation. I do want to say, though, that going back to the environmental document that we'll be publishing in the middle of this year, there's a whole section that discusses relocations and would have very specific information about individual properties affected.
And I know that there are some folks who look on a map and say, gosh, if that looks like I'm really close or it feels like I'm really close. Again, we'll put the simulations back, the visual simulations back up after we finish here. And that really does give a nice sense of, okay, especially in Rosamond, there are like three or four different locations where it'll say, if you're standing here, this is what you'll see. If you're standing there, this is what it'll look like. This is how far it really is. And so that might help with some folks who are saying it feels really close. In some cases, like if you're on Gobi, it's not as close as you might think. So, but again, that's just me. Take a look, and you can move on from there. We do have a right-of-way person in the back, if you could raise your hand, Rod. And he can give you some more specifics because he's actually doing the job in Fresno, so he can give you a sense of what he's been doing there, what that looks like, and what the process has been looking like. He also understands the law, so he can give you kind of a legal background of what that looks like. And then, of course, we have a funny one. Can you please make the train go through my house because I'd like to move? So we'll just leave that one out there. There is a question that is consistent about, you know, the feline facility is a huge, is an asset in this community and people value it. And so there is a question about how much noise will reach the cat facility and will it disturb the cats and prevent breeding?
I don't have the specific answer to that question today, Val, but certainly based upon the outreach that the authority's been doing with the facility and their board members, we're doing some focused analysis of that to provide answers to those questions.
Right, and Christy's also submitted the card. I was dealing with that earlier that talks about what is the criteria for being moved. I think Rob answered some of that. I think Juan Carlos answered some of that. Specific for the feline facility, I think that it's going to be a process, and as Rob works through his process, and you can ask Rod some of his and ask him some of his expertise in the back, and we'll see what we can do. And as you notice, there is a visual that includes the feline breeding facility, so hopefully that's also helpful.
But that visual doesn't show our property line, though. That's incorrect. We're 500 feet off of that trail line. So where they're showing the facility is that's not. We have a whole other part of property that we're supposed to expand to.
Sure.
We can't, and so that's not it.
Well, and I think that's going to end up being a factor. So again, we're working with you, and we're trying to sort it out. There's also a question about sound barriers. What's the criteria in determining where the sound barrier locations will be?
For the sound barriers, there's a specific criteria we evaluate that's established by the Federal Railroad Administration. We need to look at, going back to that visual I showed you, we measure what the noise levels are today, what they would be with the train. Where any of those criteria are exceeded, then we evaluate placement of sound barriers. And that's a pretty typical measure to reduce noise impacts along whether it's a rail line or a freeway. So definitely that's something you'll be seeing in the environmental document.
Okay. And we're down to just kind of our last few. There's a question about just the community itself. Some folks don't feel this is a fair fight. You know, talk to us about the environmental process and what options the community has in terms of perhaps adjusting the alignment.
Yeah, and
go ahead. We'll see if your answer is the same as mine.
You know, I was just going to say, I mean, we understand this is a hard project. You know, we're building a 500-mile railroad in a state with 40 million people. We're going through a number of communities, and it's hard. I mean, we have to try to balance, the goals of the project, as I mentioned earlier, with all the concerns of the communities. And we have, in some communities, done a very good job and made some changes as we could, and a lot of folks are happy about it. And then some places we haven't maybe achieved that goal, but we're going to keep trying. Will everyone in the state be happy at the end of the day? I think most people that ride the train will be happy, but it's going to be there's going to be some impacts in some communities somewhere in the state, and we understand that's hard, and we take it very seriously, and we have made lots of changes up and down the state, and rerouted made changes here and there, but every piece of land in the state is owned by somebody, and we're going to we're going to impact someone in some place, but we're going to keep working on it, we're going to do our best, it's not done yet. We're still in the environmental phase, and until we get that completed environmental document, things can just still adjust a little bit.
That was even better than my answer. The only thing I was going to say is just, again, the fact that you're all here today. I've worked on projects like this for over 35 years. And yeah, as Juan Carlos says, there's always some impacts that occur. The fact that you're here, you're learning about it, you may be opposed to it, but at least if you're going to be opposed, you're going to be opposed based on facts, not on rumor and innuendo. So it would encourage you, my encouragement would be to make sure you understand what the project is, what the effects are that are important to you, and provide comments during the public comment period, because each of those comments are taken very seriously as we work to identify the final preferred alternative.
A question about, frankly, why is the project necessary? We covered some of that up there, but I think it's not a bad thing to go over again. Why is this mode of transportation necessary, and who will ride it?
We talked about that. I mean, just the number of people that are coming to the state. I like to talk to people about, the freeway system that we have in California. They started planning and building that system after World War II. I think a lot of people are familiar with that story, but it wasn't planned and built for people in the 40s. It was planned and built for people today, but they started it in the 40s, and they knew we were going to need it, and they built it, and they're like, gee, look, it's already full. We need to add more. So that's kind of what we're doing here. I think we're planning for, your children, your grandchildren, how they're going to move up and down the state. And, we'll be able to enjoy it when it's open, but it's really for those next generations when there's, another 10-15 million people in the state, and it's gridlock everywhere. And it's just something to think about.
Okay. Two more questions left. One of them, frankly, is why are we doing it as a facilitated Q&A with written questions, honestly, so that we can hit everyone's questions and be as efficient as possible. So, we're not trying to do anything other than just make sure that we're answering questions. And even after this, again, we'll be available at each of our little stations so that you can ask whatever one-on-one questions you might have as well. And then finally, and this is always a question that comes up, and she asked it more specifically about one of our members of Congress. She says that there are a couple people who are members of Congress who represent this area who are really focused on eliminating our funding. But even from a bigger perspective, a lot of people ask, how are we paying for this project? So I think that that's a fair question. I'm gonna raise it myself, and I'm gonna ask Juan Carlos to help unpack that.
Yeah, so right now, we do get this question a lot. We have a mix of funding. We have a federal grant that was given to us in 2008, $3.5 billion. We have the Prop 1A, if you remember, there was a ballot measure that gave us about $9.9 billion. And then we have ongoing cap and trade revenue. So there's a program called cap and trade where we get 25% annually from those funds. So those are our kind of our funds that we're using now. The project's always been envisioned to be a split between federal funds, state funds, and private investment. So we get a lot of questions about the private investment and when is that coming. And what we've been told and what we understand from talking to all these entities is they want to see they want to see something getting built. And once something's get, you know, pieces are built, they also want us to get through the environmental, because with the environmental process, you know, you never know how long it's going to go. There's a lot of risk. Investors don't like that. They want certainty. And so once, you know, we're trying to get the environmental clearance, we're trying to get an initial section built, and then that's when the private investment market has said that's when they will come in. So there is a mix of that, and we do have the funds that we're using now, as I mentioned, for the construction for that early section.
Just to recap real quick, so we have our federal funds that we're currently using. We have a state bond, which is also available to us. We have cap and trade, which is going to be an ongoing source of funding, which Juan Carlos just explained. And then we also have private funding. Again, we've gone out to private industry, we've asked the question, they said they are interested, they want to be a part of this project, but it's not going to happen up front, it's going to happen on the back end. So there is a path. The funding has been identified. We are building already, and we intend to continue building. All right, so right now, as we stand here, one person cannot eliminate our funding. It would take it's a whole different dynamic at this point. With a lot of momentum behind it, we have 3.1 billion dollars in contracts out. Is it 2.9?
I think it's close to 3 billion.
Okay, about $3 billion in contracts that are already let. We have 119 miles currently under construction and under contract. So that's a lot of momentum that is already moving forward. So we have a question.
Why are they not funding our road systems? Is this rail to be transportation when our infrastructure is collapsing? Our roads are torn up. You know, we're spending a lot of money, you know, and letting, just so someone can go to San Francisco.
Yeah. We're definitely proponents of that as well. We need to be spending the money on all our infrastructure, right? I mean, we get a lot of questions about dollars. I think people don't realize Caltrans budget, I think their budget is about $10 billion a year. I mean, we are investing, but it's not enough, right? I mean, it's not enough to maintain the roads. You know, like I mentioned earlier, we do need to do that, but we also need to plan for other modes.
Well, thank you so much. Okay, we'll take one more question.
What is the total cost of this whole thing? It's $1 billion. You're saying $9 billion here, $8 billion there. That's
17.
Where's the rest of this
money? Yeah, so it's the overall budget right now is $64 billion. And as we mentioned, you know, we don't have all the funding right now. We have enough for that. Identify for that initial section that we talked about from North Bakersfield north to San Jose, and then in future years, we'll continue to try to identify additional funding. We have the cap and trade, which is ongoing, so it's annual, and then that private investment that we talked about. So they're typically projects of this magnitude, this size, even freeway projects. They don't have all the money at the start of the project. There's initial funding to start, because that there's other funding sources that come. Like the cap and trade, when we started construction, we didn't even know that program didn't even exist. And it started, and then we started getting allocation from that. So, we have to be, and that's part of what we're doing here, was getting that environmental approval so that what you call shovel ready. So when projects are shovel ready, every year, frequently different funding programs become available, and usually projects that are shovel ready are the ones that get those funds.
Okay.
Go ahead. I've seen this.
Yes, Juan Carlos, thank you for your presentation this morning. And the Rosamond News is curious about public participation in these community meetings. You've held a lot of them. And would you say it's robust, it's medium, what is it?
It varies. Generally, in this community, it's been very robust. We get quite a few people here. In other communities, it's, you know, similar. Communities have different reactions. Some communities are very supportive, and others are mixed, and some are more opposed. And we understand that, and that's why we're here, to kind of hear what the community is thinking about the project.
Uh-huh. So what would you say about, what's your assessment of Rosamond?
There's a lot of excitement here in Rosamond, but it's good. You know, we actually like it. I mean, sometimes we go to have meetings in the community and you know, nobody shows up. It's like throwing a party and nobody comes. And,
yeah, yeah.
You know, and you're trying to engage the community. Here, it hasn't been that issue. We've had a very engaged community. We've had very good attendance at our meetings and a lot of good questions. So it's been very, very good.
Well, thank you for including Rosamond. Thank you for coming.
Thank you for having us here.
Yeah, you're welcome.